50.
So for antitrust, there's been an incredible shift away from what was traditional antitrust enforcement. Typically, it was consumer harm and the economics behind it were the main drivers. Now what's being put behind it is the social element, the broader social good, and also consolidation in of itself being bad, big is bad. And what this does is it casts a pall on potential M&A. Because even if companies prevail in court, they have to go through the entire process of being accused of bad behavior in the public domain. And so it makes it more of a PR exercise, more political than empirical, and that's where it helps when you have a PR agency help you.
We're kind of in SPAC 4.0 now. Last year at the end of 2020, we were in like SPAC 2.0, and that was when the big boom hit. Everyone was investing in, all the retail were investing in these SPACs, driving the price up. And what happens is once it's above trust, you know, the SPAC investors, or the so-called SPAC mafia, will just sell their position. And who comes in but retail? And that was a big, you know, reason for, you know, in the first quarter of this year, some of these SPACs traded way up. And at the same point, they had trouble actually having a meeting. Not to approve the business combination, but because they couldn't achieve a quorum for the meeting because there's so much retail.
It is such a tough one because we're really, a lot of corporations are just getting their hands wrapped around carbon accounting and explaining their own carbon story. But we've moved way beyond that now in what we're asking for of companies. We're saying, well, what are the risks of climate? So what are the inward facing issues that could affect your company? And there's no really great consolidated way of assessing climate risk today. A lot of companies can talk about flood risk or heat risk, but if you really want to assess the potential risks of climate change to your business, you've got to go all the way up the supply chain and then all the way downstream to your customers and thinking about all the different ways that could affect your business. And that's going to be really difficult, but we're already asking for that transparency.
There is a lot more pressure on boards to meet these ESG requirements, diversity being a significant one of them. But I'd like to kind of go back to my thought, you know, kind of key thought about diversity, which is I think it goes far beyond race and gender. I think it for a board to truly benefit from a diverse group of people, there needs to be much greater emphasis on cognitive diversity or diversity of thought.
It's kind of the equivalent of ringing someone's doorbell and saying you'd like to buy their house versus putting up a billboard in their neighborhood saying you'd like to buy their house and you're going to do it whether they want to sell it or not. I think that it just really puts a company on their collective back foot. And frankly, you know, it can kind of sour the mood in the boardroom a little bit when it comes to, you know, that type of communication. No one likes to get a public letter or get a call from the Wall Street Journal where, you know, they tell you in 15 minutes there's going to be a story about how so-and-so is making an offer for your company. And, you know, your response to that reporter is, well, what do you mean? I haven't seen that letter yet. I can't comment on it. And, you know, I don't even know if it's true. And you know, what happens is in 15 minutes, the story runs anyway. So I think that there's a very wide gulf between those two types of approaches. But they both generally seem to have their time and place.
ISS and Glass Lewis say if we are compelled to change the way that we do business because of an appellate process that the regulators foist on us, then no one's ever going to trust our reports. Everyone's going to think that our recommendations can be changed. Something sacrosanct will go away. We'll eventually be put out of business. So I think they feel pretty threatened by regulation. But thus far, regulation hasn't happened. There was a major rulemaking process that wound its way through the SEC towards the end of the Trump administration, but it got shelved. And there's nothing significant pending, to my knowledge, right now.
50. I get it.